Hello, my beautiful art community. Thank you so much for watching my video today. Today I'm going to be showing you an interview that I was lucky enough to have the opportunity to do. I have followed Juan's journey for the past couple of years. I reached out to him asking if he was willing to sit down and speak with me about his work, and he was kind and generous enough to do so. He invited me to the art show that he hosted at Tree Garden. When I first arrived at his venue, I was impressed by the beauty of the nature and the positive energy all around. Before I sat down with Juan, I took my time to look at the artwork that was up in the gallery, and I was impressed. It was more astonishing and more beautiful than I had imagined it would be. For all those who don't know who Juan Villegas is, he is a popular Austin artist that specializes in elements of surrealism and figurative art. He focuses on using his art to portray his dreams. He uses symbolism in order to do that. So, without further ado, let's get started with the interview.
Hi.
Man, it's so nice to meet you, I must say.
Good to meet you.
It's so nice to finally meet you. In the beginning of my years of painting, it was really shy, so I never really got out into the art community, never really did.
Okay.
And here I am, so.
How did you come across my work?
Instagram,
okay.
Yeah,
okay.
On Instagram. I was looking at, well actually I think it was Cherry Cola Day. Next down you can play.
Okay. I was gonna say, because yeah. Were you showing there too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I was looking for the screen. And I found your name, and I was like, okay, that's what I like, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, because sometimes you just have to look at other things. Just like, how do you say you like create models or go create all of those people? I can see it in your work, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have to look at other people's artwork sometimes in order to find that niche.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta root yourself in tradition to kind of explore what you can do and what's appealing to yourself, and then you take from there, and then you take off, and then you start incorporating your own elements.
Right.
So everybody's influenced by somebody else, you know, we're all connected
to
this way.
Yeah.
You know, Salvador Dali had a great quote. He said, "What's not rooted in tradition is plagiarism."
Yeah.
Meaning, like, we're all connected, and like, I influence somebody else, and that person is going to influence the next one, and then so forth and so on, and then we're all connected through this web of inspiration. And so, for somebody to say that I do my own thing, I'm not influenced by anybody else, bullshit.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, and for sure, like, I used to be like that. Like, I'm not gonna look at other people's stuff. I'm too good for that, you know? And that's not true.
No.
I mean, I had to really, So, I had to sort of come to a humbling moment with myself and say, hey, like, everybody knows, you like art, right?
Yeah.
But you gotta be real with yourself. Where do you really want to go with that?
Right? What do you want to say?
Yeah. What are those things?
Yeah. There's a thing that I noticed in Austin, and there's artists who have a very deep understanding of what they're about, and then they show that, they portray that in their work, and there's people who are solely focused on the aesthetics. And so there's the art with meaning, and then there's the art for looks. And I like the one with meaning, because I think art has the power as a catalyst for transformation. So when you have the right intention to convey a message, art is a powerful tool. But if you just want to use it to decorate, it's fine too, but you lose kind of like that power to really transform people's perception. And so there's too much of a focus in aesthetics and awesome, but not much meaning.
I feel that.
And that's what I've seen, and I wanna
kind of
bring something
a little bit more.
Yeah, bring something different to the table.
Because you see something that you don't necessarily, I guess, find tasteful, right?
It's not tasteful, but it's not inspiring. And if the art doesn't move me, then I don't think it's doing the job. In my opinion.
I feel that.
So like, art is supposed to move you. Spark something in you, but then when that connection is not there, then what is it? What is it? Yeah, is it even art?
Yeah.
Which is a the greatest question of
all time. What is art? What is art? Right? Yeah. Question of all time.
Yeah. So, I like to think art is an expression, but with an intention. Mm.
I like to think so too.
Yeah.
My questions of the day. Yes.
Is that all the questions?
Pretty much, yeah. I guess, well, so looking back on it, looking at your artwork and then looking at my stage of artwork and using that as an inspiration. Let's say we could go in a time machine, right?
Yeah.
What is something that you could give a word of advice to somebody that's a beginner artist?
An advice for somebody who's starting would be to not give up on your craft, because it takes a long time for people to notice. Like, I've been doing this since I was out of high school.
And
I had to have a day job for the longest time to be able to support myself. So this is not something that happens overnight where you're like, I'm an artist.
Boom. Oh, yeah, done. No. Definitely not.
Like, I've been making art since I was a kid. Like, you know, my dad put a newsprint pad in front of me when I was 4, and then gave me some pencils and gave me some clay, and then I just started messing around with drawing and with sculpting. And then it wasn't until I was in high school that I started picking up painting. But I had already been building my drawing skills, and then I finished high school and I went straight to art school. I'm Colombian. Columbia, and I didn't move here until after high school. I was 17 when I moved here.
And you moved to Houston.
I moved to Houston.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I went to art school there, and then I started picking up. I took up everything, even if I didn't like it. And I took up theater. I took up music. I took up drawing, sculpture, ceramics, photography. I wanted to get my hands on everything because I wanted to find what was my forte. And then I found that drawing and painting were my calling. Graduated, I just started picking out jobs at galleries. I worked at Texas Art Supply in Houston, which is like the biggest art supply in town, and got a bunch of free art supplies or discounted supplies. And I was like in touch with all the artists who work there, and then you start having group shows with people. But I still have to support myself, so get a day job. But I never gave up, and I think that's the key. Artists who are starting is to like keep building that momentum, and then if it's meant to be, and if you're disciplined, you keep working on your craft and you develop a message. Because like, what do you want to say? It's very important. I feel like that sets you apart from everybody else who's trying to make art. What's your message? What are you trying to say with your work? And how are you staying true to yourself too? You know, like, we take influence from other people, but how do we make that our own? Like, what's gonna be the thing that makes your work work?
Right. You know? Maybe going into it and knowing that nothing, I guess, is really original, right? But making it our own individual.
Your touch makes it original.
Yeah.
Because like, you can replicate whatever painting you want, but like, you're always gonna have your touch. I know that there's people who. The professionals to replicate paintings, but if you're staying true to yourself and you have an influence of a style, your work will still be your work. And I think that's important for people to know, like, not to be too caught up. Do I look like somebody else? Or is my work too derivative or whatever? That all evolves with time.
Yeah.
So you gotta stick with it. I think that's what most people don't. Most people fall short is they don't stick with it. They'll probably try to show for a couple of years and then they give up because they didn't see any immediate results. And we live in a society that's very much about instant gratification.
Mm-hmm.
So like, if something doesn't come true for you in a few months, then you give up for a few months.
I love that you said that. You said it so beautifully.
Yeah.
So
you gotta stick with it. And you know, how many? I got turned down so many times from galleries before I didn't get turned down. You know.
Yeah.
So you can't give up. It just means your work is not ready yet. It doesn't mean that you suck and you need to just go find something. because if it's your true, if you're passionate about it, then you shouldn't let that get you down or make you stop. Because I think there's also that. Many people maybe don't know what they want. And because they don't know what they want, they jump on things quickly. And then since they don't see results, they move on. So if you have the passion, if you have the discipline, don't give up. That would be my advice. And eventually things will start coming. It's like it's all about what vibration and what intention you put out into the universe. I believe in like if you believe in what you're doing, yeah, wishing and not believing. If you believe in yourself and what you do, and you put in the work, you'll see results. But they don't come overnight.
No.
Like I'm 33 years old and I've only been a full-time artist for a few years now. But I've been making art since I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, and I've had day jobs up until a few years now. And I was able to, you know, take off on my own.
So inspiring. Like, honestly. That's so inspiring.
So yeah, you just gotta stay with it.
Keep going.
Don't let the day job get you down. Just use that as a stepping stone. Yeah, it's like somewhat of save money. It's a way to save money and fund yourself while you find people who can fund you.
I like how you talked about getting turned down because it's really difficult for artists to come to terms that they're going to fail, but failure is a part of growing. At least in my experience, you know, I just got turned down the other day from a poster, you know, like an art gallery.
Icosa?
Oh yeah.
I still get turned down.
Oh man, you're hilarious.
It's also every gallery has its own niche.
Yes.
Every gallery has its own particular way of looking at art, and you're not gonna fit with everybody. So like before you apply to a gallery, you gotta see what they're showing.
Yeah.
See what artists are supporting. And if you think you might be a fit, then apply. But if you're gonna apply to an abstract gallery, like they're not gonna pick you.
No.
They're not gonna pick you, no matter how good you are.
Yeah.
So it's always good to know that. Like, look at the gallery, research the gallery, and if you think you're a fit, then apply. And if you get turned down, then whatever, apply again next year. You know,
just keep applying.
Bother the shit out of them.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfection.
That's how you get your name out there. You gotta fucking be there.
Yeah.
Be at openings. I mean, right now with COVID, it's a little tricky now, so it's a new challenge for people starting. But still, like, be on the lookout for shows, like befriend other artists, like go see their shows, talk to people, can't be afraid to talk to them. I was super shy, and it took me a long time to get comfortable just like coming up to people and be like, hi, what are you, what's your place about, like can I know about it, like how can I show here, and just people can be ruthless when it comes to approaching people and like asking. Got nothing to lose.
Right.
Yeah.
The worst thing you can be told is no.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
Right? Or maybe your art sucks, but I'm pretty sure they wouldn't say that.
I know, like, how many artists do you think, like, got in a show, do you think because they applied once and they got in? No, they probably were on that for I don't know how long until they got in. You gotta keep pushing until people are like, okay, who are you?
My professor says, expect to get turned down 9 times out of 10.
Yeah.
And maybe more.
Yeah. Until you hit the one that gets you in.
Yeah.
Also, we live in a town that's very DIY, so if nobody's accepting your work, then put on your own art show. I did that. You know, I still do that. I'll find a place, a venue that's looking for art, and I'll curate the show, and I'll install the show, and then I'll have a show. And then I don't know about their first, third party involved. Find a way. You know, the gallery world is changing so much now. It's not anything what it used to be. Like, artists don't need galleries to sell or show work anymore. They just need that space. Whether that's a coffee shop or somebody's rental property or some venue. To be honest, that's the limit. Even outside, build some walls with some friends and have a show. guerrilla marketing, you know? That always works.
Yeah.
So there's possibilities on end. You gotta get creative.
Yeah. Because there's so many things that are out there to discourage you. Yeah. There's plenty of things to discourage
you. And there's
you.
A lot of competition.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody in Austin is an artist.
Yeah.
You know? So, how do you compete with that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you gotta get creative with the way that you show, who you associate with, you know, like what's the work, what are you trying to say with your work, what are you trying to, like, what are you trying to say with the, what's your image as an artist as far as your presentation and your meaning and your work, and so also knowing what to turn down, what opportunities to turn down, because from experience, a lot of people in town, a lot of event promoters and event coordinators who just want to utilize talent for their benefit. So gotta be careful with that too.
Yeah.
Never be too hungry to accept the show where you're not getting paid or you're not or you're being taken advantage of just for exposure. You know, like exposure is great up until a certain point.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, if you're starting, then yeah, you might want to pick up a few of those gigs where you just get exposure and that's it. But at some point, you can stay there. A lot of people stay there. And you let other people take advantage of your work and your talent, and then. And then the rest of us can't get paid because free art beats any other art that's for sale. You know, if there's somebody doing it for free, people are not gonna care about quality so much as far as like that guy's gonna do it for free.
Right.
You're gonna go with that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. No matter how talented or lack of talent. You know, so they should be like a union of artists. Get paid, so we all help each other. And don't pick up any free gigs if you don't see any benefit in your effort. Yeah. Exposure alone doesn't cut it.
Doesn't get it for you.
No. Well, what does it matter how many followers you have on Instagram?
What does it do for you?
What does it do for you?
Yeah.
What is it doing? Are they all buying your work?
Right.
Are they all coming to your shows? To get that social media stuff out of their heads. Like, it's good as a platform to share and whatnot, but it doesn't matter what followers you have. It matters who's showing up for you, not liking a post.
Wow.
I stopped caring about that this year.
Yes. Wow.
It's like, for the moment.
I'm glad I got that on tape. Oh. Wow, that was really amazing.
we're all getting that sucked into that game.
Yeah, we do.
I'm like, oh my god, I gotta get the likes.
Yeah. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. If you reach the right people, you get three. If you become friends with three people who support your work, then you don't need 50,000 followers. You just need a few people to support. And so I think COVID has brought that opportunity a little more to life. Because like now that we can't have big shows, it's not about the quantity. Now you have the opportunity to have more intentional shows where you bring the right people into your show. Want to cater to. It's important.
Now, who's the audience?
Who's your audience?
How does your art reach that audience?
Yeah. What do you say with that? And like, does it matter on it? What does it matter if you have 1,000 people in your show or if nobody's buying anything?
Right.
Everybody just wants to see you for the free booth. You know?
There's that too. You know?
Yeah.
Or maybe people that want to interview you. I don't know. Those dang people, you know?
Well, alrighty then, that looks like that's going to be it for today for the first part of my interview with Juan Villegas. I look forward to dropping the new ones, but for now, I guess ta-ta for now, and don't forget to like and subscribe to my channel to keep this thing going.